Indeed, very happy to speak here today. Usually I'm not that happy when I have to speak as the last person, but today there's a kind of exceptionalism. I can directly refer in my presentation to some issues which have already been touched upon yesterday by Peter, but also today by Janis, Christian, and even by Juan. So I think in terms of the wrap-up, there's definitely some use in the fact that this will be the last presentation today. One thing which not has been touched upon yet is something which is the CRUD. Probably Kari could have told more about the CRUD because he is Estonian. I did never see a CRUD, but I would know how it looks like, look like. No. This is some kind of, it looks like this. It's basically a magical creature in Estonian mythology made of hay and household items. And once you gave 3 drops of blood to the devil, this creature would become alive and would do all kind of work for you, especially work in the gray area. It would steal things for you. But the problem is basically that you have to keep the CRUD busy, because once the CRUD runs out of work, it will kill you. And the Estonian government, and this is why I start with this, saw in a very maybe wise precipitation here parallels to devices of artificial intelligence. I will state the Estonian government, essentially CRUD was a servant built from hay and old household items. Therefore, maybe it's not a, it's not a conclusion which has to be followed, but the Estonian government uses this character as a metaphor for AI and complexities. So the Estonian AI strategy is called CRUD. We have actually, with our institute, developed a legal framework for the use of artificial intelligence, these CRUDs, research which now was completed in May of this year. Basically, what I will do in my presentation, as quite a few issues have been touched already upon, I will really focus on these kind of autonomous systems and their impact on private autonomy. Maybe just about this term, autonomous systems and private autonomy. You see it already, there's already, in terms of the term itself, a contradiction, or not a contradiction, but a certain kind of tension here. I can't have full private autonomy at the same time when I'm actually applying autonomous systems. No, I can't have 2 times autonomous here. Maybe a little bit as an introduction, if we keep this short, because I said it was touched upon already. Emergence of internet spurred fears already 10, 15 years ago for strengthening private autonomy, even anarchy coming up. This is something I hear quite often when I do cooperation with the IT sector. It was Palau in 1996 in its declaration for the independence of cyberspace that the internet is perceived as a new world where legal concepts of property, expression, identity, movement, and context would not apply. That's basically an approach which is very much supported by the blockchain community. If you look a little bit into their arguments, today these anarchic tendencies of internet have largely been tamed. It's a book here on blockchain technology. Don't be afraid, I won't talk much about blockchain today, even not smart contracts, although there are those compulsory 90 seconds I have to leave on this. Today it's comprehensively regulated. Some states deploy firewalls. So basically, there's not that much touch on private autonomy in this field. Basically, if you look at the internet as such, and then the e-commerce, it intrinsically maximizes private autonomy, but is restricted not on a legal, but rather on factual levels. And this is basically what we mentioned, or it was mentioned yesterday when we talked about service and goods provided, and or today when we come to search engines. So basically, search engines work as gatekeepers here. And if you look simply at the concept of private autonomy, one would say that you do not have the full choice if you have not a full access, if there's not transparent data on what actually will later form not only the partner of your contract, but also the content of your contract. Second aspect of e-commerce is that there's standard business terms by default, even more than we have in retail as a general practice as well. Simply, as added arguments now, because the relative anonymity of the users, there will be nothing left of any kind of form of negotiation here, and the sheer number, of course, just the dimension of transactions online. A third aspect touching on private autonomy is the provision of digital tools by the state, other public bodies. That's only a small fragment I touch upon simply because of the Estonian background, because quite often contract parties will have an interest in being provided with tools which provide evidence for the respective contract to be concluded, usually a signature. We have this digital signature in Estonia, which in general, just as the digital tools as such, generally increases private autonomy because it's an added choice. But if you then get into an environment where it's becoming an absolute standard that you sign your contracts with this card, of course, you are effectually barred from certain kind of contract partners if you are not provided with the respective devices, or if you do not have basically this card, right? So I need the hardware and the card for it to provide a signature here. That's only a small aspect which I won't touch so long upon neither. If I go into e-commerce in general, there is also similar patterns for performance and settlements of eventual disputes. It's not only about the formation of contracts and the respective contract content, but it is also then how the respective duties are performed, and especially also what happens then when it comes to dispute. This is usually, and much more than in retail, than if I look at, for instance, at the PayPal standard business terms, basically an entirely private legal system with ADR and other forms of even arbitration. Then finally, and it's the most essential impact, which I mostly touch upon today, those tools autonomously generating deletion of intents on behalf of the user. What is their impact of private autonomy? And they're basically, historically, two steps here. It started all with those computer declarations, which were already kind of controversial in terms of interpretation in the very beginning. There's this case decided by the German highest civil court, 2012, this German online, this online ticket sale case, where it was stated that in terms of interpretation, declarations of intent, it shall either way always be exclusively the human perspective and not the way as the system interpreted this decision or this declaration of intent. Maybe 1 minute on the background, somebody wanted to buy two tickets online, first one for himself, the second one for somebody he would like to determine later. So into the interface, he wrote "to be determined" in the field which was reserved for the name. And of course, the system accepted this kind of offer later when he tried to basically replace these words with a real name. The airline got aware of this background and they said, actually, we do not have any contract at all. That ended up at court, and then the BGH argued that this is not a case where the airline company could declare avoidance to the contract because there would not even be an agreement. And this actually was a little bit controversial. I'm actually also not so convinced by this approach for reasons I touch upon a little bit later when we come once more to now completely autonomously generated declaration of intent. Finally, this kind of smart contract thing. Well, legally, smart contracts are about as complex as a chewing gum vending machine, but it's either way beyond the legal sphere quite popular topic I'm permanently approached with in connection to this entire blockchain thing. So I will use a few words on this as well. Basically, the advantages are in theory that there's a self-performance of obligations to a contract. You can kind of restrict disclosure of data if you wish to. And an extended smart contract, and this is the only point where it becomes a little bit legally interesting, you can also apply automatic sanctions in case of non-performance, follow-on contracts. Challenges now in terms of private autonomy would be, of course, you cannot make use undetermined legal terms, even if you wish so, in order to keep your contract, for instance, flexible because you can't translate it into code. Now, basically, there's a very restricted area of application for smart contracts here. And protection of weaker parties, consumer law maybe in general, also minors actually, of course, is nothing I can really carry through in terms of smart contracts because this pseudonymity is one of its core features. hindering also later litigation. If I'm not happy what the smart contract performed to me, it's basically impossible to track down who is my contract partner now in real life. And then finally, and this is maybe the legally most interesting point, those open source libraries of smart contract code provide samples, basically just standard business terms. And since there's this automation bias, I will be usually be inclined as a user to simply take over what is provided to me online as open source. And if you now think a little bit to who is probably the author or on whose on the protection of whose kinds of interest these kind of libraries are created, we come very soon again to the monopoly issue here. Chains of circumstances cannot be foreseen. Okay, that's kind of obvious. Creditor might have interest to not insist on performance, just also now having a look at the creditor's perspective, because maybe I would just like to maintain good relations to my customer, and so I do not enforce or I do not even ask for payment for at a certain point of time, which is not possible if I set this on a smart contract. And finally, the range of performance at all is also restricted by the reflectability in code. If you now put this once more in a little bit bigger framework, present digital ecosystem erodes private autonomy mainly in terms of the choice of contract partners and the respective contract contents, but now smart contract basically expand this pursuit to the creditor's attitudes towards non-performance of contractual duties. So it's not only contract formation and contract content, but also basically the entire life circle of the contract, which becomes standardized. And then, of course, to the detriment of private autonomy. Okay, but now on those software agents and beyond, basically here on this guy in his virtual form, if I use them as a more tool, I mean, maybe I'll explain a little bit how these indeed work. Software agent is basically an autonomous system as a part of artificial intelligence, which basically does not, according to any kind of determined criteria, come to certain kind of decisions. Usually making use of deep learning. Deep learning is a subgroup of machine learning. So we have artificial intelligence, which has several kind of aspects. NLP is this natural language processing, which is then used in order to make the AI system communicate with environment, usually the human environment, but then there is this machine learning, and one part there is this deep learning thing. And they can be applied as software agents, and they are called software agents if I apply them in the field of creating legal relations on behalf of the user. What's important there, that this decision making and really takes them place in a called black box. Decisive criteria are not deductible ex post anymore. This is basically something we touched upon yesterday with 13 to 15 GDPR. I got a little bit in practice here a few weeks ago. There was the conference on advanced information service, no, information system engineering. And we talked about this in the conference about a case in Germany. There's the Ruhrport, basically the largest not seabound port worldwide, which is run by one of those systems. And this is not something in terms of science fiction. We really are already that far that one of the main fields of research there is actually to find out or to deduct how the system came to certain kind of not only decisions, but how to find out why the system works in a certain way. So basically, we are running after these kind of machines. They're also migrating from hardware to hardware, so it's basically technically not possible to really switch them off. And the question is then, of course, what happens if I use these kinds of really developed deep learning-based autonomous systems in the legal field, not only running a port, but my proper legal relations, or if I'm a company, my management. For private use could be connection to some wrist device here, which just orders foodstuff which my body needs because it's calculated on behalf of, or on base of my body function, blood values, and so on. Or for a company, managing the entire import-export under sole criteria to maximal on a profit, or also sales if I'm a manufacturing company. What's getting then really interesting? Okay, I have this kind of deep learning system based facility here, or system or software. That's only one system, but they may also start to communicate with others, with others. So if you imagine that an algorithm is quite simple, basically two dimensions, it gets three dimensional if I have the deep learning, because it's a neural network on minimum 9 layers. So basically it's the same way it's constructed as the brain. This is already quite complex, already too complex actually to deduct what's going on there, but they start then interacting with each other. So basically the complexity which we reach at this stage is definitely not anymore anything where we can dogmatically say that they create declaration of intent for which I can be held accountable. It's not anymore the old thing, the user sets some criteria and then the system simply calculates. This is just too far. And the question then is, of course, what does this mean for private autonomy? And what does it mean, actually, in legal terms? I mean, it's called software agent, so there's definitely some kind of alleged parallel to agency or representation in general, but we need legal capacity for agency, and we don't have this, although it has been promoted by this European Parliament motion 3 years ago, not really taken serious among legal professionals and scholars, but highly popular beyond, especially once more in this IT community, who do not only ask for e-capacity, but even sometimes for more for their intelligent systems. If I look at it dogmatically, what I would say, since I can't apply a representation or agency law here, it's basically the same as we have as a blanket declaration, or this blank declaration, will basically declare to agree to everything which later is filled in into this document, which is then filled in by the software agent. But of course, that's not something I would, as a lawyer, suggest anybody to use in practice. Because basically, what's happening here is that I degrade from private autonomy or from contract to something which is quite similar to common law strict liability under tort law, because I do not actually have awareness anymore on what the system is buying, doing, generally contracting on behalf of me. Basically, this private autonomy, making use of these systems, get outsourced. And we have a little bit of a similar phenomenon here to what we have in the GDPR with this privacy paradox and data protection. Basically, definition would be people consistently indicating that they value their privacy, simultaneously disclosing their private data comprehensively and for free, which can a little bit declared or explained by the fact that usually in practice they don't have a choice if they want to buy something or if they want some service or if they want to get their profile online. But for private autonomy, it's a little bit more complex, I would say, because here it's not about the integrity of your identity, but it's really about the question, what kind of rights and duties I do or are created on behalf of me. This privacy by default intended to be set up here in 25 GDPR, provided or organized or implemented then by technical organizational measures. Basically, private autonomy by default could also be implemented by technical measures. The question is only, what would this in practice then really mean? Of course, basically, the main target would then not be the integrity of my data or integrity of my identity, but the main target would be transparency, simply to be informed about what is actually going on behalf of my person or on behalf of my company, of my legal status. So transparency would be the focus here. I mean, these examples which I have on this slide, they're partly already covered by consumer law, but they go beyond that because they are not only consumers which are addressed by this issue. This is also C2C, B2B, and especially it is also something which I would like to know internally in my company, what is actually now the status quo of my legal relations here. Could implement a duty to inform how to assess which essential rights under national law are waived when company dispute resolutions are accepted. It's a very specific example. But what I would like to focus on, this is this last point, the duty to inform in real time in which software agent-generated legal relations a user finds himself in, and even more important, why. Maybe use it to find out what kind of contracts I have, but I would like to know, I would be very much interested into knowing why I have a contract or why I bought this. What's actually the triggering reason which actually led to this decision? I know it's partly impossible, but there should be this kind of base information level. And I think this is maybe not more, but at least as important as this question of data integrity intended to be protected by the GDPR. And there are some approaches for implementation, could be certificates for autonomous systems, which do comply with this kind of basic information duties. Of course, we always have this problem of information overkill, right? If it's in another standard business term add-on we have here, it's maybe, again, this automation bias that the user will not really spend much attention on it. And of course, with the private autonomy basic approach, it's always the right to simply waive private autonomy as well. What could be a solution here is something what is called UX, so user experience design and production. Basically, that you try to make the use of certain kind of devices, but also information, as intelligible as possible. Just addressing this presentation of data measure, I mean, there definitely would not be any kind of use if we have now another 100 pages which have to be read in their entirety if I want now to inform the user what kind of legal relations are created and why. There should be then maybe again or probably again making use of artificial intelligence devices some kind of, it's a vicious circle then, but it should be presented in a way that the user indeed can focus the attention on the essential points of it. Yeah, and the last thing is a little bit provocative, which I also don't see to happen in very much near, in very near future. Main risk to private autonomy may in that respect not be arising from global private companies and their human boards. And so it's also then not a consumer law issue, but it may be indeed something like this in its virtual form, where we even do not need some kind of awareness for, we even do not need this kind of e-capacity or this kind of e-person for that, because once we really deploy these devices for global company management or for comprehensively managing my private legal relations, they will be quite competitive in a way, because they actually are not addressed by all those flaws and biases addressed above. There is full access to information without basic, also in terms of granular limitation here. We had to compete with economically. There, of course, for the time being and also in the near future, there will always be either legal person or a natural person behind it, but they will be interested in being comprehensively informed which kind of legal relations are created. So basically this transparency point is the main point I would like to make here. And I think this is not only a protect-worthy concept among individual partners, but as I just mentioned, also a human interest of control and transparency in general, which should maybe slightly be more taken into account when we look in a little bit into how to regulate this issue in future. And that's basically what I prepared for now, but I think it's a very, very striking topic, which I will be happy to discuss. Thank you. Mm-hmm.